COVID-19 is impacting communities across the country, and Indigenous communities are, of course, no exception. So I thought that it would be great to check in with Jennifer Brant, an assistant professor at the Ontario Institute for Studies and Education at the University of Toronto. Hi, Jennifer.
Hi, Sam.
Could you explain for us some of the health discrepancies and structural barriers that are unfortunately always present, but perhaps might be amplified right now?
So COVID-19 has really pulled back the curtain on the devastating history that Indigenous peoples have endured with infectious diseases and the ongoing unfairness evidenced during this current pandemic. So if we were to consider things like Canada's failure to deal with the ongoing boil water advisories across First Nations communities and the risk that this poses to sanitation, but in addition to that, the communities that actually have do not use advisories, and so these communities can only wash their hands with bottled water and hand soap. These are commodities that are suddenly hard to find for all Canadians. But in First Nations communities, one can spend over $7 for a 3.7 liter jug of water. Health disparities for Indigenous peoples really should have been a wake-up call. In 2009, when we witnessed the deplorable numbers with the ways in which Northern communities were hit during the H1N1 outbreak. So if you think about the population of Indigenous people in Canada, we make up just around 4.3% of the population, but during the first wave of H1N1 accounted for 27.8% of all hospital admissions and 18% of deaths. When communities reached out to Health Canada, in response, they were shipped dozens of body bags. So really, like, you need to think what kind of message this sends to Indigenous communities who are already facing multiple forms of systemic racism.
I have to ask, what has been done so far to protect Indigenous communities and give them better access, and what still needs to be done to ensure their well-being?
Sort of towards the end of May, that a relief fund for Indigenous peoples living off reserve and in urban centers would be allocated, but it was expect to take several weeks to roll out, right? So we're at that several week point now.
Yeah.
So like, this isn't a time when we can really wait. And so that support was going to be aimed more at like access to food, as well as community-based projects. So again, vagueness around what this is going to look like. But they all appear to be band-aid level responses, right? And fail to address of the structural inequities, such as access to safe, clean drinking water. Like, that would be a start. And I find it shocking that we're still having this conversation today after years of calling attention to the issue.
I know that Indigenous peoples are resilient and adaptive and have been for millennia. So what are some of the ways that your communities are banding together, even if virtually?
And one of the responses that we've seen, particularly with the Six Nations Reserve, but other Indigenous communities across Canada as well, putting up barricades to prevent access to visitors, right? To kind of like stop the spread of the disease in the community. And part of that was inspired by Project Protect Our Elders, right? Which acknowledges the importance of protecting our elders, the most vulnerable of our community, right? But also our elders being our knowledge keepers, right? Who hold our language and our cultural knowledge. What is really inspiring is that we're also seeing Indigenous communities come together, as you mentioned, virtually, right? And so we're seeing things like the Jingle Dress Dance, which has also been connected to the history of the Spanish flu pandemic, right? That's when the Jingle Dress came about. And so a century later now, we're seeing this virtual Jingle Dress. We're seeing things like videos featuring Indigenous chefs cooking healthy foods in their own homes, in their own territories. We're seeing Indigenous youth creating TikTok videos, right? And a big part of this is just that sense of togetherness. Even though we're physically separated, the virtual community has been so strong.
That's amazing to hear. And I thank you so much, Jennifer, for making time to chat with us and for your leadership always. Thank you so much for being here and teaching us a little bit more about the beauty and resilience of your people.
Thank you.